Our story begins on May 24, 1863, at a little house in Hamburg, Germany. On that day, Professor Oscar Lewis comes home from work early. "Look," he says to his nephew, Axton. "This wonderful book comes from the old shop near here, and it's got Arne Saknussemm's name in the front." "Who's Arne Saknussemm? And what's the book about?" asks Axton. "I can't read it." "That's because it's in old Icelandic. Saknussemm's an old Icelandic scientist from the 1500s. And this book's more than 400 years older than him." Just then, they find a dirty, old paper in the book. "Look," says Professor Lewis. "It's a secret message, I'm sure." Professor Lewis and Axton want to understand the message on the paper. They work on it all afternoon. "It's no good," says the professor angrily that evening. "I can't understand it." And he goes out of the house for a walk. The fire in the room is very warm. Soon Axton feels hot. He moves the paper in front of his face. Suddenly Axton can read the message through the paper. "It is a secret message from Arne Saknussemm," he thinks. "But it's backwards." Now Axton understands the message. He's afraid. Just then, his uncle comes home. Axton is afraid of his uncle, too. "Well, Axton," says Lewis, "can you understand the message now?" "Air." "Yes, uncle," says Axton. "You must read it backwards." "Of course," says Professor Lewis. "Good boy." "That's it." The professor reads the message, "Go down into the crater of Snaefells before the last day of June, when the shadow of Skartaris falls across it, and you can go to the center of the earth, Arne Saknussemm." "Uncle," Axton asks the professor, "where's Snaefells?" "In Iceland," answers Lewis. "It's an old volcano." "But, uncle, nobody can go to the center of the earth and come back alive," says Axton. "It's very hot and dark down there, I'm sure." "Yes, they can. Arne Saknussemm's message tells us that," says Lewis. "But is his message true?" "We must go to Iceland and see." "Now remember, Axton, this is a secret," says Lewis. "We want to be the first scientists of our time to go to the center of the earth." Later, Axton meets his fiancée, Grauben. He tells her about his uncle's secret plan to go to the center of the earth. "I don't want to go," he says. "I want to stay here with you." "Of course you must go," says Grauben. "What a wonderful journey. And when you come back, you can marry me." All the next day, Lewis and Axton get different things for the journey. At last, late that evening, everything is ready. At 5:30 the next morning, the professor and Axton leave for Iceland. "Goodbye, Axton," says Grauben. "Remember, I'm waiting for you." "Be quick, Axton," calls Lewis. "Our train leaves Hamburg at 6:00. We must be on it." Professor Lewis and Axton take a train to Denmark. They've got a lot of luggage. The next day they arrive in Copenhagen. There Lewis finds a ship. They sail across the sea to Iceland. Lewis feels bad because there's a storm at sea. On the 13th of June, they arrive in Reykjavik. When they get off the ship, they can see a mountain. "Look over there, Axton," the professor says excitedly. "That's Snæfells." Many people come to see the boat arrive. The professor and Axton meet a science teacher. His name is Mr. Fredriksen. "You can stay at my house," he says. In the evening, the professor and Fredriksen talk about Iceland. "There are lots of interesting things for a scientist to see in Iceland," says Fredriksen. "Really," answers the professor. He doesn't want to tell Fredriksen about his plan. "Yes. Do you know Snæfells?" asks Fredriksen. "It's a volcano." "A volcano. That is interesting. Nephew, we must visit the Snæfells mountain." "You can go there on foot, but you need a guide," says Fredriksen. "I know a very good man. We can meet him tomorrow." The next morning they meet Hans Jelk. "Can you be our guide and take us to Snæfells?" asks the professor. "We must arrive there before the 30th of this month." "Yes," answers Hans. "I can." Soon their luggage is ready. They take a lot of food and water with them. On the 16th of June, they leave Reykjavik. Lewis and Axton are on horses. Hans walks in front, and two more horses take the luggage. 1 week later, they are near Snæfells. "It's an old volcano, but old volcanoes sometimes erupt, too," thinks Axton. "Snæfells has two tops," says the professor. "And we're going to the top of Skartaris, over there." They leave the horses and begin to go up the mountain. Axton soon feels tired, but the professor is excited, and he stays not far behind Hans. When they arrive at the top of Skartaris, they are cold, hungry, and very tired. It's midnight, but they can see the light of the sun in the sky. The next morning, Professor Lewis speaks quietly to Hans. "Axton and I are looking for the center of the earth. Do you want to come with us?" "Yes," says Hans, and the three men begin to go down into the crater. When Hans and Lewis and Axton arrive at the Biosk arm of the crater, there are three black holes in front of them. "Where do we go now?" asks Axton. "I don't know." "We must wait and see," says the professor. It is the 28th of June. Suddenly the sun comes out, and the shadow of Skartaris falls on one of the holes. "It's Arne Saknussemm's sign," says Professor Lewis excitedly. "Come on. We go down that hole to the center of the earth." They go through the hole and climb slowly down. It takes them 10.5 hours to arrive at the Biosk arm. What a very long climb. Now they are 2,000 meters from the top of Snæfells. In the morning they eat breakfast, and Professor Lewis looks at his compass. "Now," he says, "the journey begins." They take lamps and go into a big, dark tunnel. They walk for a very long time. Axton and the professor look at the crystals in the walls of the tunnel. "What wonderful crystals!" Axton says. "Yes," says Lewis. Hans walks in front of them. He doesn't say a thing. On the second day, the big tunnel stops suddenly. In front of them, there are two small tunnels. Which tunnel do we take now? Asks Axton. The tunnel on the left, says Lewis. They go into the new tunnel. Slowly they walk down it, but sometimes the tunnel goes up for a time. Uncle, perhaps this is the wrong tunnel. It's going up, says Axton. But Lewis doesn't listen, and he doesn't stop. After 5 days of walking, the tunnel stops. We must go back, says Professor Lewis angrily. But Axton is worried. We haven't got any water, he says. They go back to the first big tunnel. Now they go down the small tunnel on the right. But they can't walk very well because they are all very thirsty. That night, Axton is sleeping when he hears a noise. He opens his eyes at once and sees Hans. Their guide is walking away with the lamp. Where's he going? Maybe he's leaving us, thinks Axton. He closes his eyes again tiredly. An hour later, Hans comes back. Water, he says quietly to Lewis. Come. Axton, get up, cries the professor, and they quickly follow Hans. After some time, they can hear water through the tunnel wall. Hans makes a hole in it. Water comes out, and at last they all drink. Don't close that hole, Hans, says Lewis. Now this stream can be our guide. The next day, Hans, Lewis, and Axton follow the stream down the tunnel. The professor looks at his compass. Where are we now? Asks Axton. 200 kilometers southeast of Snaefells, so we're under the sea, answers his uncle. When the tunnel goes down, Professor Lewis is very happy. Sometimes they stop, and the professor writes in his book. How many days is it before we go back? Asks Axton. We've got water now, but not much food. Be quiet, Axton, says Lewis. I'm writing about our journey. Axton is walking down the tunnel the next day when suddenly he loses Hans and the professor. He walks back, but he can't find them. Just then, he falls and breaks his lamp. Oh no, he cries. Axton sits and waits in the dark. At last he hears something. He puts his head near the tunnel wall and listens. I can hear Hans and the professor, he thinks. They're talking. But where are they? Help, cries Axton. Help. The tunnel wall takes Axton's cries down to the professor and Hans. Axton. Are you okay? The professor calls back. We're far in front of you. Come on down here. Axton begins to walk. But he can't see anything. Suddenly his foot hits something and he's falling down. Axton falls for a long time. When he opens his eyes again, he's in a very big cave. Axton. You're alive, cries the professor. Yes. But where are we? Asks Axton. I can see light and I can hear the sea. Are we under the earth now or not? Yes, Axton, we are, says the professor. There's a big underground sea in front of us. We must go across it. Hans is making a raft. Soon the raft is ready. They put their luggage on it and begin to sail across the underground sea. They sail for many days, but they don't see a thing. Suddenly, two sea monsters come out of the water. They're fighting. I must tell Graubin about these monsters when I get home, thinks Axton. Hans quickly sails the raft away from them. Hans, Lewis, and Axton sail on the raft across the underground sea. The professor is looking for land. Look at those clouds, says Axton. A storm's coming. The raft is sailing very quickly now. There is a lot of lightning in the clouds. Suddenly, some blue and white lightning comes from the clouds. It explodes over them and breaks the raft. Just then, the raft hits some rocks. At last, they are back on land. How can we go back to Snaefells now? Asks Axton. Go back? What are you saying? First, we must find the center of the earth, says the professor. Hans finds the luggage and begins to work on the raft. He wants to make it ready to sail again soon. Lewis and Axton go for a walk. They walk over some rocks. Suddenly, the professor finds a dead body. It's the body of a man. Oh, no, thinks Axton. Are there men living down here? They walk to the trees in front of them. These trees aren't green because there's no sun. Through the trees, Axton can see some big land monsters. What are they? He asks. Oh no! Look at that! They're coming nearer, he cries worriedly. They're mastodons, laughs the professor. They aren't living on Earth now, but they are alive down here. Just then the professor stops. Look over there, Axton, he says quietly. In front of them they can see a man. He's very tall and he's walking with the mastodons. Quick! Back to the raft, before he sees us, cries Axton. The professor runs after him. Not far from the raft, Axton sees something on the ground. It's an old knife. Is that your knife on the ground? He asks the professor. No, answers Lewis. He takes the knife in his hand. But let's see. Why is it here? Perhaps I know. Lewis looks carefully at the rocks near them. Soon he finds something interesting. Look, Axton. The letters A-S for Arnsaknasem, says the professor. It's a sign from his journey here in the 1500s. We must go down this tunnel now. After that, Lewis and Axton go back to the raft. All their luggage is on it, and the raft is ready to sail. Quickly, Hans says the professor. Let's sail to those rocks over there. When they get to the rocks, they can see the tunnel with the letters A, S next to it. Let's go into this tunnel and follow Arnsaknasem, says Professor Lewis. They take the lamp and go into the new tunnel. Soon they come to a very big rock. It's in the center of the tunnel. It's no good, says the professor. We can't go through the tunnel. This rock is stopping us. Just then, he remembers the gunpowder in the luggage. Let's blow up the rock, he says. Then we can follow Saknasem. Hans goes back to the raft and brings the gunpowder. He puts lots of it near the rock. He takes the lamp and lights the gunpowder. Then Lewis, Hans, and Axton get on the raft quickly and sail away from the tunnel. 3, 2, 1. A few minutes later, the rock explodes. Suddenly, the sea water runs through a big hole in the cave wall, and the raft goes with it. Down, down, down. The raft goes down with Lewis, Hans, and Axton on it. Minutes later, the raft is moving very fast through a big tunnel. Lewis lights the lamp, and Axton can now see the luggage. We haven't got much food there, he thinks. Then the raft goes over a waterfall. When they arrive at the Biaskarm, water from the waterfall falls on top of them. Everything is dark and very quiet there. Am I dead? Thinks Axton. Hans lights the lamp again. They are in a small tunnel, they can see. Look! We're going up now, says Lewis, excitedly. Up, asks Axton. Where's this tunnel going? Can we get out of it alive? I don't know, Axton. But let's eat, says the professor. I'm hungry. They eat, but soon there is no more food. It's hotter and hotter in the tunnel now. And the raft is going up the hot tunnel very quickly. Axton looks at the water under the raft. But there isn't any water now. The raft is moving on lava. Axton is worried. What's happening? He asks. We're going back to the upper world, says the professor. We're in a volcano, and it's erupting. But where is this volcano? Thinks Axton. Suddenly, the raft comes up out of the tunnel and into the sky. It is moving very fast now. A few minutes later, it comes back down and hits the ground near a mountain. Are we back in Iceland? Asks Axton. No. This isn't Iceland, says the professor. Everything's green here. Come on, says the professor. This lava's very hot. Let's walk away from the mountain. Lewis, Axton, and Hans get off the raft and begin to walk quickly away from the volcano. Soon they see a small boy under a tree. What's the name of this volcano? Lewis asks the boy in a number of different languages. Finally, the boy understands when the professor speaks in Italian. Etna, he answers. So, we're on Etna in Sicily, in the south of Italy, says the professor. That's 5,000 kilometers from Sneffels. Hans smiles for the first time on their long journey. After that, they take a boat back to Germany. When they arrive at the professor's house in Hamburg, Grauben is waiting. Now you're a hero, Axton, she says. Please don't leave me again. Soon Hans says goodbye and goes back to Iceland. Professor Lewis writes a book about his journey to the center of the Earth. After that, he's a hero for scientists across the world. And Axton is the happiest man on Earth when he marries Grauben.